Good morning, everyone. Happy April 16th, which is episode 153. Yes, 153. Is that 3 years yet? 50, 50, 150? Almost, right? 50, 50, 50 is 150. 3 times 2 is 6. Almost at 3 years, if you can believe this, which I'm really not sure where 3 years went. But 3 years in we are. You know, I'll tell you. I never had this problem before, and I tripped over it again. This was my, I got to get the mouse focus over here. My OBS, there's a recording versus streaming, and sometimes I got to figure out a way to get these things lined up. Anyway, distraction. So again, welcome. And let's get started. So for those that are new to this or haven't seen this before or haven't seen it in a while, this is something I've done for quite some time. It's just basically what I talk about. I've always talked about disruptive technologies. I've always looked into them. I've always been fascinated by them. It's kind of what really floats my boat, as I like to say. So it's every Sunday morning at 9 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Again, this is just a continuation of decades of work, to be honest with you. If you go out to my YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/keeppace, and you go over to playlists, you'll see all these wonderful playlists and everything we're doing, which is all things GPT-3. I'm up to whatever it is, 16 videos at this point. So I expect this to grow over the course of this year, because that's pretty much all I'm talking about. So, and the only difference between what you're seeing and what goes on there, YouTube is kind of the archive, as it were. So I just basically, you know, trim the dead space at the beginning and the end. And that's pretty much the only changes I make. This is my weekly reading. And there's things that I read that, you know, sometimes they make it in that week. Sometimes they kind of go on the shelf until I can bundle them together. There's really no rhyme or reason to each week. You do get George Unfiltered, as I like to call it. Some of what I do starts with, you know, the wow articles that try and bring you in. You rarely see a wow article here. You typically, I delve a little deeper. Is there something that gives me the big picture? Is there something that gives me a detailed view? That's what makes this particular week. Again, there's no weekly theme. It's kind of, if I see enough articles that I think are enough for about 20 minutes of conversation, that's how we get here. So the first little piece of news, this coming April 20th, I was supposed to be speaking at a webinar on this AI Innovation Summit, and it seems that the host had a slight mishap, so they've had to push this off by 1 month to May 18th. So it's no longer going to be the April 20th, it's going to be May 18th, which is fine for me. It doesn't really matter one way or the other. I continue, the presentation in of itself is, you know, 99% completed. I'm just It's two last pages that I'm just tweaking, but it's given me an opportunity now to get even deeper. So, you know, the negative is it's another 4 weeks off or whatever that is. The good news is it's going to be just that much better simply because I'm going to have another 4 weeks of knowledge in my head on the space. They're up to 4,400 people, which is, I know, I've also learned that the cutoff on this is going to be 5,000. So if you haven't registered yet, Roz, I'll get that at the end. There's a slide at the end that I'll show you. But it's everything is Keep Pace. My channel name is Keep Pace. Dr. Roz is asking, can you compile a link to your 15 GPT videos? It is a playlist. So if you just go to youtube.com/keeppace and just click playlist, it's the first one. So anyway, I know that they're going to cut this off at 5,000. I also know that obviously not everybody attends, you know, when this is on. So I'm sure that there's going to be recordings, and I haven't seen all of that work yet. I do know I have spoken with the host. He has seen the deck, really likes it. So it is now May 18th, no longer April 20th. So good news, bad news. So this was an interesting week, and it was an interesting week only because of two announcements, number one, and then I'm going to share with you some what I call behind-the-scenes work. This is the things that you don't necessarily see, but it's going to give you that, again, I've done this before. These are the examples of as to how people always ask me, like, George, where do you start? Good morning, Anthony. You know, everyone asks me, like, George, what site do I go to, or what should I read, or what's your recommended, you know, reading list? What I would say is, I've evolved this over time. There is no singular thing I do. It tends to be more curiosity-based. So I have kind of my, you know, my basic articles, as it were. I have my basic Google alerts, as it were. But then every now and then I find something, and that one thing kind of opens up this whole new space that I just start reading, and then it becomes yet another source for me. Today is going to be kind of that. So the first two things, and we talked about this a little bit over the past 3 weeks, I think. Elon Musk has founded a new company called X.AI. Now, a little out of bounds, about, I think it was this week, maybe it was the end of last week, I don't remember, talked about that Twitter, as the company name went away, and that Twitter is going to be, you know, sucked into this thing called, you know, X.AI, or whatever the heck the thing he was talking about is, making Twitter this bigger platform. We also talked about that he was disappointed or expressed dissatisfaction with the fact that OpenAI had gone quote unquote commercial, because the idea behind OpenAI was that it was in the name Open. So there was these rumors that he was going to start up an AI company shortly after Microsoft had that $10 billion investment. And now all of a sudden these things are trickling out that he's bought thousands of these graphic processing units, GPUs, because at the end of the day, and again, I'll give you a little, you know, little Jeopardy lesson here. GPUs were the mechanism that closely aligned to AI. There's actually a thing out there called a TPU, which is a TensorFlow processing unit. Google learned that if you take a GPU and you kind of tweak it or hone it, all those mathematical calculations can be, you know, simplified or whatever it was. And they actually, there's an actual thing called a TPU that Google uses for AI research. So then they just talk about the references. The Financial Times reported that Musk planned to open an AI firm to compete with the Microsoft-backed OpenAI. Musk even reportedly sought funding from SpaceX and Tesla investors to get the company started. So if you just go out, I'm in the wrong order. There were numerous ones of these. This was this one was from The Verge. I saw a number of them that were all basically the same type of thing, but it's not clear where he's going to go yet. It's not clear what's out there yet. It's not clear. There's a whole bunch of other questions I still have. It's one thing to have the engine. It's another to make sure that it gets used. So obviously Microsoft has a, you know, the advantage, because they're going to put it into Office. They're going to put it into Bing. They're going to put it into those things that people can consume readily today. Where do they end up putting these? And oh, by the way, the next one is the same general, it's the same but different. So one of the things to visualize is not so much these large language models, because as we've talked about, there's going to be a bunch of them. This is always the first phase of these exercises, where everyone and their mother seems to come out of nowhere and they've got a, you know, their large language model solution. And then just resources alone kind of dictate where the market goes. There's only so many people that can support these things. There's only so many people with the knowledge to support these things. There's an underlying cost. So again, right now we're just kind of in awe of how many are coming out. The reality of it is there will be a point in time when this gets winnowed down. It happens every single time. So that was the first one. You know, Elon Musk, this is that whole Twitter and AI, and who knows, you know, where this is going to go. But again, I wish I could tell you I was surprised, but I'm not. Now, the next one was interesting. Well, again, surprised, not surprised. This was the 14th. This was just the other day. I think this was Sunday. This was on Friday, if I'm not mistaken, maybe Thursday. Amazon launches AI tools to rival ChatGPT, Microsoft, and Google. So, Amazon wants to become the bedrock of artificial intelligence. The e-commerce giant just announced a proprietary set of core AI technologies that companies can use to build generative AI applications, much like Microsoft applies OpenAI's GPT-4 as a foundation of new Bing Chat. The program called Amazon Bedrock is a suite of foundation models that are part of Amazon Web Service tools. It includes proprietary models like Titan, as well as FM from AI21 Labs, Anthropic, and Stability AI. So take a big step back. Let's go back 5 years, I guess. So I was doing AI presentations even back in 2018-ish, 2019-ish time period. And one of the things that both Microsoft and Google and Amazon had talked about is democratizing AI access. So what they're doing here is, and again, Amazon's another one of those platforms that you need the compute and the packaging in order to pull this stuff off. So remember, there's levels of all of this. Level, you know, ground zero, as it were, is if, what's the word I want to do? I don't want to use the, I'll just use the word academia for here. If you've gone through the courses, if you've gone through the effort of understanding the primary pillars of building these models, you understand the statistics, you understand the math. I think that's a very unique subset of people, I'd say. There's this other level where some of these, that work is going to be packaged so it can be consumed. You're going to see that on Microsoft Azure. You're going to see that on Google Cloud. You're going to see this here on AWS. So you're seeing where they're giving you the building blocks so your application teams don't have to be experts in this, rather that they can consume these models. So again, I'm not surprised that AWS has come up with a similar suite. They've had AI tools previously. Again, this gets us to what I said on the previous slide. You're going to see a bunch of competitors come out. The people with the deep pockets, the people with the existing platforms, they tend to win. So Amazon is probably going to be one of those winners. Google is doing a lot in the healthcare space. Looks like they have the deep pockets and can be a winner. Microsoft has Azure. Now remember, just because you got these, let's just say those are the three winners. There could be more. But if you have those three winners, realize that there's no industry standards for the learnings of those to be shared across models. I'm working on a whole series of blogs that are going to talk to this very idea of trust, in a sense. But realize that right now they're all trying to figure out how they get their piece of the pie, as it were. Nobody's talking about industry standards. Nobody's talking about these chatbots that if George Pace uses chatbot A and then uses chatbot B and then uses chatbot C, that there is this commonality, as it were, that each one of those chatbots knows who I am. So I don't have to reestablish that relationship all over again. So again, I get it. I see all of this. I see where it's going. I've seen this before. We're just going to see these announcements. I would say probably for the rest of this year. At the end of this year, I think all of the major announcements will be done, and then the industry shakeout starts. So that's my working assumption, my best guess, as it were, my educated guess, as it were. So again, not seeing anything that's different. It's just, I expected this. So I know I have a wide audience of people. I don't even remember how I tripped over this, to be honest with you. I don't remember if somebody sent this to me. I really don't remember how I got here. If you want to understand at a somewhat technical level, this is the article to read. And it's entitled, "What Are Transformer Models and How Do They Work?" Now, you'll see this thing up here. It's called C-O-H-E-R-E, cohere.ai. So there's a site. It's actually one of the models that's in here. It actually breaks this down into relatively simplistic terms of how these regenerative models work. Now, I will tell you, I have probably read through this I was also busy at the time. I've read through it several times. I will keep rereading these articles because it doesn't answer every question that I have, answers most of the questions I have. Now, another thing about this, and I'll jump ahead very quickly on this, it also links out to something that I have been doing behind the scenes that I may or may not have shared with you guys. There is a site, I believe it's called, or pronounced, shall we say, Archive. It's A-R-X-I-V, so arxiv.org. All of these white papers that are coming out in the AI space are finding their way to this archive site. So as you go through this, what are transformative models and how do they work? You'll see that there's a number of links and acknowledgments to where this article had been based off of and built off of, and it's fascinating stuff. Now, mind you, the deeper you get, and I'll show this to you, the deeper you get into these articles, the closer you get to the math. Just so you're, this is not what I would call, you need a little technical acumen, a little bit, to read the first article. It's not that crazy bad. When you start delving into the white papers and they start talking about vectors and they start talking about, you know, the statistics and how they're mapping this over, you know, how kind of the math behind how these models are working, it starts getting deep. You don't have to get that deep, but I'm telling you, this is a good article. If you really want to get a narrative as to how these things are working, this is a really well done blog entry. So again, it's if you just look up what are transformer models and how do they work, and COAGRE. I mean, I'll put this up in the when I record when I put this up on my YouTube playlist. It you know, I'll put it in the comments. But this and it's relatively recent. If you look, it's from December 4th, 2023. I literally just stumbled over it this week. It's really, really a good read. Do I have any diagrams in here? It had a couple of diagrams. You know, you're going to start hearing things like embedding, tokenization, attention. And again, they go through the definitions of each one. So token embedding, this is kind of how it talks about how these language models have been created so that words have context. So it's taking kind of how they've built these vector models, in a sense, so that when they break down words in a sentence, they can actually group them. And that's what this embedding is about. Transformer blocks, this thing of attention to figure out different words and their meanings. It's a really fascinating article. So I would tell you, this is on kind of my top five list. It's probably my top two list, to be honest with you, of things that I'm reading to give me that insight. So just, again, excellent article. It is a little technical just by its very nature, but I think if you just stay on this particular blog article, it's good enough. If you start clicking out on the links, you're going to either get to other blogs or you're going to get into deeper content. So, and actually, deeper content's not all that bad. You can kind of skip the quote-unquote math part. There's enough there that you can read the description to say, okay, I get it. And this is kind of, you know, what are transformer models? This is like the summary. Transformer models are one of the most exciting new developments in machine learning. They were introduced in the paper Attention is All You Need, which is linked in the article. Transformers can be used to write stories, essays, poems, and answer questions, translate between languages, chat with humans. They can even pass exams that are hard for humans. But what are they? You'll be happy to know that the architecture of transformer models is not that complex. It simply is a concatenation of some very useful components, each of which has its own function. And they talk about what those different functions do. So again, very enlightening article. You probably will end up reading it more than once. I can tell you, I go back as a refresher because it's part of my education that I'll have that in my head that I could go to the whiteboard and eventually do this. So I don't have it. I understand it conceptually. I just don't have it integrated into my gray matter yet. But excellent article. Probably one of the best I've seen that explains it. So the last two that I have for today really come out of Archive. I'm sharing with you how a couple of things. One, Archive is now what I'll call that scientific/academic source, where all of that academic research, all of that academic work is kind of getting published. And I believe that's what Archive is about as a site. This first one that I saw, when did it come out? I want to say 2 weeks ago, but I don't remember. Could have been within the past 10 days. Give me a second. So this came out on April 2nd. So yeah, I saw this shortly after, this was submitted on April 2nd. So I probably saw this about a week and a half ago. And I've got a list of these Archive articles too. I haven't had time to really organize them and work through them. But if you go to the site, I guess this is sponsored by Cornell University. I'm not exactly sure, but you'll see on the right-hand side PDF. So obviously if you click on the PDF, this is kind of just an overview of these Archive articles, right? So it's when it was submitted, what's the abstract, then you start getting into some of the math or some of the comparisons of the math. There's actually ones. I want to see if in here or anywhere. Give me a second. I don't know if it was this one or the other one. Bear with me one second. I'm gonna go back a second. Is it this one? Yeah, I've been reading a couple of these. Okay, so there, some of them will have the math very early on. It will talk about, you know, the different principles or the different pieces of math that they used to create these articles. So again, realize the deeper you get into these archive articles, some may be good, that they're good for a non-technical audience. Some get very technical very quickly. So just understand it's out there. Archive is a good site. You know, this particular one about large language models, this is more of a conversational one as far as I was concerned, where they start talking about, you know, this attention thing, which is talked about in the previous blog article. So they survey the evidence for 8 potentially surprising items of what they're learning about these large language models. They predictably get more capable with increased investment. Well, that goes without saying. Many important LLM barriers emerge unpredictably as a byproduct of increasing investment. They don't necessarily know how it figures this out as it goes through this. This gets us, in a sense, to the explainable AI piece. LLMs often appear to learn and use representations of the outside world. There are no reliable techniques for steering the behavior of a large language model. Experts are not yet able to interpret the inner workings of large language models. Human performance on a task isn't an upper bound on LLM performance. LLMs need not express the values of their creators, nor the values encoded in web text. And brief interactions with LLMs are often misleading. This is the context window and what have you. So they're starting, when we talk about the trough of disillusionment, this is starting to say, okay, it's doing all this wonderful stuff, but now here's the reality of those things. So that was the first archive article. And then the second one is a bit of a future for me. It's this thing that I came across about 2 weeks ago again. There's these thing called generative agents. So it's this ability for them to build agents that can interact with one another. So believable proxies of human behavior can empower interactive applications ranging from immersive environments to rehearsal spaces for interpersonal communication to prototyping tools. In this paper, we introduce generative agents, computational software agents that simulate believable human behavior. And again, if we go to this last one, and you see kind of the, well, again, I'll go back up for a second. So this is the archive article. Again, it came out on April 7th. Again, all of these are relatively new finds. If you click the PDF and we download them, you'll see that they created all of these different agents. They gave them, you know, the various rules. And then what happened as they started to interact with one another and what they learned. So, you know, you keep asking yourself, what's, you know, we're here, but what's the next two things out? I actually am going back and updating the original model that I showed last week of what that, you know, what ChatGPT, what the large language model ecosystem looks like. It's articles like these that are helping me build the subsequent versions of those diagrams. So I probably have a good month of reading ahead to read, assimilate, kind of dream it, and then get it into the diagram format. So but this is this week is a little bit different. Normally I talk about news, and which was the beginning. It's rare I get into the technical details per se. This week was one of those weeks. So as I keep saying, GPT is my focus. Large language models are my focus. The more I read, the more it's dragging me in. And Dr. Oz, just so you can see here, these are my my Keep Pace channels. YouTube.com/keeppace, and then just click on playlists. It's the first one. That'll get you to all the GPT playlists. Substack, keeppace.substack.com is where I'm going to be blogging. I'm working on a 7-part blog, 6-part blog right now. It's actually a component, or it's another piece of the presentation that I'm going to be doing now in May. It deals with this concept of trust. And I've got some an interesting diagram about it, number one. And I've got some interesting thoughts about it, number two. But I want to make sure I can bring in some of these other, what is this called? These generative agents. I'm bringing that into that model as well. So I've got a little more homework in front of me to make this make a little more sense to me so that I can diagram it. But so that's what I had for you guys this week. It's the news just keeps coming. It doesn't seem to slow down anytime soon. So I'm finding that the archive articles are a wealth of information. I'm trying, Dr. Oz. This is a complicated space. The funny part is I've told people before, for those that don't know me, I've done this really throughout my career. I did this before there was this thing called the internet and, you know, all these other tools, let's just say, that were out there. So being that I was in corporate America for most of my, well, all of my career, I really did learn how to basically create this framework, as it were, this skeleton that I would then add all of this connective tissue onto. So you're really watching me form a foundation that I form for almost any space that I've ever entered. That's why if it seems a little, you know, haphazard sometimes, or it's a little jumpy at times, it's just the way my brain is wired. I never really try and get down to a singular, what I want to call it, but my foundation is usually several pillars. I'll say it that way. And I may be halfway down understanding one of these pillars, as it were. And then all of a sudden I'm like, wait, this is related. And this is probably another pillar as well. So the unfortunate reality is that when these new technologies have evolved, and I'll use the term day one, you know, day one, day two, day three, there's usually very little guidance. You know, you may have to go to a conference. You may have to find a speaker on YouTube to get that insight. What I'm trying to do is act kind of as that broker here in this particular space that says, I get it. There is no path in front of me per se. If you want to learn, you know, if you really want to get a deep understanding, well, this is how I've done it throughout my career. So, whoops, what did I do here? There we go. So anyway, yeah, Dr. Oz, you don't want to know what goes up in my head. So one of the things I'm going to be working on this year as well is getting more followers. So Dr. Oz, if you could pass this around to your networks and put some, you know, good words around the email, it would be appreciated. So I'm actually a little disappointed. I really did want to do that April pitch because the April pitch is great. It really is. It's one of my better pieces of work. But hey, I get four more weeks now to tweak, and there's really not a whole lot to tweak. In all honesty, it's again, there's one or two slides that are more informational, they're educational, they're at the end of the deck, so it's more of the summary stuff. The major pages are, they're done. There's really nothing outside of, at this point, I'll have several episodes of the this whole trust idea that I'm working on. That'll be out, so it'll be out before the presentation, which is good. And you know, so it's another 4 weeks of a little bit more practice. I mean, I'm at 18 minutes with it. So again, it's done as far as I'm concerned. It's just now a matter of, can I sneak in one or two other additional thoughts based on what I'm learning? And between now and then, there'll probably be something. So that's what I had for you guys this week. I hope you, I really would tell you, go back and where is it? What are transformer models and how do they work? I'm telling you, this is, keep that article at the ready and keep reading it until it really sinks in, because this is, it's really well done. It's really well done. So with that, everybody, go enjoy the rest of your Sunday. Have a great week, and we will be back again next week to do it all over again. So until then, everybody, take it easy, and we'll talk then. Bye.